Hello everyone. Today we'll be dealing with the topic of Module 3 of Wireless Cellular and LTE 4G Broadband, that is Overview and Channel Structure of LTE. So this comes under the Chapter 6, but in Module 3 it is the Chapter 1, that is Overview and Channel Structure. Till now in the other two modules, we have discussed the inherent challenges, associated technical solutions in designing a broadband wireless network. From here, that is from the third module, we'll describe the technical details of LTE specifications and we provide an overview of LTE radio interface. So as we know, this overview of and channel structure of LTE, in this we have introduction to LTE, channel structure of LTE, downlink OFDMA radio resource, and uplink SC-FDMA radio resource. So before going into the topics, I just want you to know that there are following acronyms which are used in this module. So whenever I say it is MT, so it should come to your mind that it is a mobile terminal. Similarly, BS is base station. 3GPP is third generation partnership project. RAN is radio access network. CN is core network. UTRAN is UMTS, Terrestrial Radio Access Network. UMTS is Universal Mobile Telecommunication Service. EPC is Evolved Packet Network. EPS is Evolved Packet System. EUTRA is Evolved UMTS, that is Universal Mobile Telecommunication Service, Terrestrial Radio Access Network. EUTRAN is Evolved UMTS, Terrestrial Radio Access Network. RNC is Radio Network Controller. ENode-B is Evolved Node-B. High Speed Packet Access is HSPA. GERAN is GERAN or GSM/Edge Radio Access Network. HSDPA is High Speed Downlink Packet Access. Similarly, HSUPA is High Speed Uplink Packet Access. So these are the acronyms you need to know in this module. So going to the introduction or overview of LTE radio interface. The radio interface of wireless network, whenever I say it is a radio interface of a wireless network, it is the interface between the mobile terminal and the base station. So interface between a mobile terminal and a base station is a radio interface. Now here, this third generation partnership project, that is 3GPP, it actually defines a separable network structure. That is, it divides the whole network into a radio access network and a core network. So which makes it feasible to evolve each part whichever we consider independently. LTE is long-term evolution project in 3GPP. We know that LTE comes under the project that is 3GPP, which mainly focuses on the enhancement or enhancing the UMTS terrestrial radio access, that is UTRA. So the 3GPP mainly focuses on the develop of UTRAN, that is 3GRAN. That is radio access network, and mainly the core network which are developed within 3GPP, and on optimizing this 3GPP's overall radio access architecture. So another parallel project what we have is Evolved Packet Core, that is EPC, which mainly focuses on the core network evolution with a flatter all IP, that is the architecture we have studied in the first module, that is IP architecture or flat LTE architecture. So flat, it mainly focuses, that is EPC mainly focus on the core network evolution of all IP architecture and packet based architecture. So the complete packet system containing of LTE and EPC is called as evolved packet system. So if you have a complete system or packet system which consists of LTE and EPC, it is called as evolved packet system. Here LTE mainly refers to as in this module, LTE is also referred to as Evolved UMTS Terrestrial Radio Access, that is EUTRA, and the RAN of LTE is also referred to as EUTRAN. If it is RAN, that you then you specify that LTE as EUTRAN. If not, it will be EUTRA. So the complete architecture of RAN with respect to 3G and 4G is given in the figure. So you can see the radio interface architecture of UTRAN and EUTRAN, where there it is just mentioned as node B. Here it is E node B, but see the RNC core network combination. So you have their RNC then given to the node B, or from the node B to the RNC. Here it is just the core network and a radio interface which is happening. So the radio interface of a wireless network is the interface between the mobile terminal and a base station. So thus in case of LTE, it is only located between RAN, that is radio access network, EUTRAN, and the user equipment. So compared to the UMTS, that is UTRAN for 3G system, which has two logical entities, that is one, as you can see, is node B in the figure, and that is called as a radio base station. Node B means it's radio base station, and the radio network controller, that is RNC. The EUTRAN network architecture, if you see, it is simpler as well as flatter. So it is composed of one logical mode, that is evolved node B, E node, the other figure, and there is one more, is nothing but it is directly given to the core network. So it has only one logical component or logical node. So the RAN architecture of UTRAN and EUTRAN, which are shown, is compared to the traditional node B. So the E node B supports additional features. Now what you have mentioned there, E node B. So this E node B, it has evolved node B, has additional features, that is radio resource control, admission control, and mobility management, which was not there in case of the UTRAN. So simpler structure simplifies the network operation, this simple structure which we have, and allows for higher throughput and lower latency over the radio interface. So it is given that the node B supports additional features, that is radio resource control, admission control, as well as a mobility management. So coming to the introduction of this LTE, when we consider the introduction of LTE, we know mainly it is designed for high speed data service, like how we have studied in the module 1 and module 2. So which is why we say that LTE is a packet switched network from end to end and has no support for circuit switched services. So this low latency of LTE and the quality of service architecture, which allows the network to emulate a circuit switched connection on top of packet switched framework. For example, you can say voice over LTE, or it, you can see in your mobile phones it is given VoLTE, that is voice over LTE. So circuit switched connection will be on top of a circuit packet switched network. So it is evolved packet core network in case of LTE. So when we design this LTE network, so there are certain design principles of LTE. The LTE standard, we know it is mainly designed as a completely new standard with new numbering formats, with new documentations, and it was not built on previous versions of 3GPP standards. So earlier elements which were used, if there was a compelling reason for them to exist in the new standard. So basic design principles that were followed in 3GPP while designing the LTE specifications mainly include the 7 factors, that is network architecture, data rate and latency, performance requirement, where it is mainly dependent on spectrum efficiency, mobility, coverage, and multi-broadcast, multi-service, that is MBMS service. 4th one is radio resource management, deployment scenario and coexistence with 3G, flexibility of spectrum and deployment, then interoperability with 3G and 2G networks. So in detail, we have to look into each of the design principles now. So the first one is network architecture. Now basically we know LTE is designed mainly to support packet switched traffic with support for various quality of services, classes of service. So previous generations which we have seen, that is UMTS or HSPA, and 1XRTT or EVDO, which also support packet switch traffic. But this was achieved by subsequent add-ons. That means for that particular service to use, you have to add some features to that network. So for example, if you take HSPA, which is called as packet switch protocol or packet switch over the air, it was built on top of release 99 UMTS network, and then as a result carried some of the unnecessary burdens. That means it had a problem with circuit switch network. LTE, when you come to LTE, it is completely a different case. So it's a clean slate design and support packet switching for high data rate services from the starting itself. So LTE radio access network, EUTRAN, which was designed to have minimum number of interface, that is minimum number of network elements, while still being able to provide you the efficient packet switch transport for traffic belonging to all quality of services classes, such as the conversational, real-time, streaming, non-real-time, and the background classes. That is with respect to the network architecture. The second one, what you have, it is with respect to the data rate and latency or delay. So the design target for downlink and uplink peak data rates for LTE are around 100 Mbps and 50 Mbps, that is megabits per second, when operating at a 20 MHz frequency division duplex channel size. So the user plane latency is defined in terms of the time it takes to transmit a small IP packet from the user equipment to the edge node of the radio access network or vice versa, so which is measured mainly on the IP layer. So target for one-way latency in the user plane is around 5 milliseconds in an unloaded network. That is, if only a single user equipment is present in the cell. For example, if you take for control plane latency, the transition time period for a camped state from a camp state to an active state is less than 100 milliseconds, while the transition time between a dormant state and an active state should be less than 50 milliseconds. So mainly if you are defining the data rate and latency, you have to see the active state and the transition between them. Third one you have is performance requirement. Now here, as I've said, you are specifying in terms of four factors: spectral efficiency, mobility, coverage, MBMS service. But when you come to spectrum efficiency, the average downlink user data rate and spectrum efficiency target is 3 to 4 times of that of baseline HSDPA, that is with respect to downlink. So similarly, in the uplink, average user data and spectrum efficiency target is 2 to 3 times that of your baseline HSUPA, that is with respect to uplink. So the cell edge throughput measured is as the 5th percentile throughput, and that should be 3 to 4 times or 2 to 3 times that of both downlink and uplink. Then mobility requirement for LTE is to able to support handoff or mobility at different terminal speed. Now, you know, handoff is nothing but suppose a person is at one location using the mobile phone and there is one more person using the same network, or if this person is moving, for example, you say from Karnataka to Kerala. So if it is, since it is now taking that particular network to one more state, so you have to transfer all the details to one more state. So that is nothing but handing off this particular cell to the another cell or another location. So in that case, the mobility requirement for LTE is able to support this handoff as well as the mobility at different terminal speeds. So maximum performance is expected for the lower terminal speeds of 0 to 15 km per hour. So with minor degradation in performance at higher mobile speeds up to 120 km per hour. So LTE is also expected to able to sustain a connection for mobile terminal speeds up to 350 km per hour. But with significant, again, there will be a degradation in the system performance. The third one, what we have is coverage. Now, for the cell coverage, the above performance target should be met up to, we say, it is 5 km. For cell ranging, which are up to 30 km, there will be a slight degradation on the user throughput, which is also again tolerated, and a more significant degradation for spectrum efficiency is also acceptable. But the mobility requirement should be met. So whatever we are transferring or we are using for that particular property of the cell, so that has to be met. But even these changes what we have there in the degradation of the signal, that is all acceptable. So cell ranges up to 100 km should not be used or should not be used by the specifications. Fourth one what we have is MBMS service, that is LTE should also provide enhanced support for this multimedia broadcast and multicast service compared to your UTRA operation. The fourth design principle what we have is radio resource management. So in this radio resource management, it covers various aspects, such as the first one what we have is enhanced support for end-to-end quality of service. Second is efficient support for transmission of higher layers and support for load sharing or balancing, and policy management or enforcement across different radio access technologies. So fifth one design principle is deployment scenario and coexistence with 3G. So if we consider at a high level, LTE should support the following two deployment scenarios. So the first one what we have is standalone deployment scenario, where the operator deploy LTE with no previous network deployed in the area or with no requirement for interworking with the existing. Existing what we have is UTRAN or JERAN. So second is integrating with existing UTRA or JERAN deployment scenario, where operator already has either a UTRAN or a JERAN network deployed with either the full coverage or partial coverage in the same geographical area. The sixth one design principle we have is flexibility of spectrum and deployment. So now, in order to become a truly global standard, LTE was designed to operable under a wide variety of spectrum scenario, including its ability to coexist and share spectrum with existing 3G. That means LTE, whatever we have designed, now it gives you different kind of the spectrum scenarios, having new features as well as it is existing with your 3G technologies. So LTE service providers in different geographical areas which have different spectrum in terms of carrier frequency and total available bandwidth, which is why we say that LTE was designed to have scalable bandwidth, that is from 1.4 megahertz to 20 megahertz. So in order to accommodate this flexible duplexing operations, this LTE was designed to operate both in frequency division duplex as well as time division duplex modes. So there's all general part you have in this first and second module. So I'll not be explaining you what is frequency division duplex or time division duplex. The seventh design principle is interoperability with 3G and 2G networks. So now here, it means we have to operate in 3G as well as 2G also. So that is multi-mode LTE terminals which support both UTRAN and JERAN operation with acceptable or should be able to support measurement of and handover as well as from one location to another location or to one location to another location, both 3GPP UTRAN and 3GPP JERAN systems, with it should be having an acceptable complexity, that is with respect to terminal complexity and network performance. Now coming to, so these are the seven different design principles which I've seen. Now coming to the first one design principle, that is network architecture. So this is the figure which represents the end-to-end network architecture of the LTE with various components of the network. Now here you can see in the figure, it has the entire network is composed of radio access network, which we call it as EUTRAN, and the core network, which is EPC, both of which have been defined as new component of the end-to-end network in release 8 of 3GPP specification. That means LTE is different from the original UMTS, since we know that UMTS is defined for a new radio access network, but used the same core network as previous generation edge technology we have studied, that is enhanced GPRS. So the main components which we have in EUTRA and in UPC are, so first one we have, as you can see in the figure, that is user terminal. So the bottom one is called as user terminal. That is nothing but your mobile terminal. So the next one what we have is, the next layer after that is E node B. That is, we know it is enhanced evolved node B. So it is also called as a base station. So here it terminates the radio interface protocol and is the first point of contact to UE. So you can see E node is the point of contact to your user equipment. So from the user equipment, it will provide the air interface. It terminates the air interface protocol. So E logical node B. So here is the logical node in EUTRAN. So mainly it includes some functions such as radio bearer management and uplink and downlink dynamic radio resource management, data packet scheduling, mobility management. So when we say of these functions, it was not supposed to be there in terms of node B in case of UMTS. So the next parameter what we have is, or next component what we have is mobility management entity, that is MME. So you can see in the figure, it is represented as S1MEE after E node, or it is MME which is connected from S1 to MME. So this mobility management entity, which performs similar function to the control plane of legacy serving GPRS support node, that is SGSN. So it mainly manages the mobility aspects with respect to 3GPP, such as gates, gateway selection and tracking area list in the management, or tracking area list of management. The fourth component which we have here is service gateway, or it is called as serving gateway. It mainly terminates the interface towards EUTRAN and routes data packets between EUTRAN and EPC. So you can see in the figure, service, that is serving gateway, that is in between mobility management MME and PDN gateway. So it mainly interfaces towards EUTRAN and it routes data packets between that EUTRAN, that is which is connected from S1 to, and EPC, that is with respect to the center what we have those elements with respect to that. So in addition to that, it is the local mobility anchor point for inter E node B, which handovers and also provides an anchor for inter 3GPP mobility. So other things which it can do is intercept charging and other some policy enforcement. So the serving gateway and the mobility management, both MME, may be implemented in one physical node or separate physical nodes. The fifth one what we have is packet data network gateway or PDN gateway. So this terminates the SGI interface towards the packet data network, and it also routes the data packets between the EPC and external PDM. It is also a key node for policy enforcement and charging data collections. So it also provides an anchor point for mobility with non-3GPP access. So the external PDN, which can be any kind of IP network, as well as the IP multimedia system, or it is called as IMS domain. So this PDN gateway and the serving gateway may be again implemented in one node or separate physical nodes. So you can see that PDN gateway is connected to serving gateway through S5. It can also be connected to your, it will give you the routes the data packets between the EPC, or there is one external PDN network which is shown there, packet data network. So it can give you an external PDN data as well. Next we have is that is S1 interface, which is represented there in between user this E node and the mobility management or the gateway, that is S1 interface. It is the interface that separates the EUTRAN and the EPC. So it is split into two parts. One is called as S1U. Mainly it carries the traffic data between E node and the serving gateway. S1MME is called as, or S1MME is, which is a signaling only interface between the E node and the MME. If we see the figure, so you can see there S1 interface. First one is S1U, which is right under the serving gateway. So this S1U will carry traffic data between E node and the serving gateway. One more is S1MME. So this is a signaling only interface between E node and the MME, which is represented in the figure. The next one we have is X2 interface. It is the interface between E nodes B. So consisting of mainly two parts. One is called as X2C. It is the control plane interface between E nodes B, that is mainly used, or E nodes B consisting between E nodes B, while the X2C is the user plane interface between E nodes B. So if we see in the figure, so X2C, it is, you can see in between the E nodes, in the below EUTRAN, it is represented as X2 interface. So this X2 interface, it is mainly the interface between E nodes. One we have is X2C. If it is X2C, it is control plane interface between those E nodes. If it is X2U, it is user plane between, or user plane interface between E nodes. So here it is always assumed that there always exists an X2 interface between the E node Bs and that need to communicate with each other. For example, for the support of the handover. Then what we have is a policy and charging rules function, that is PCRF. Again, it is mainly, the name itself says, it is mainly used for policy and charging controls. One more is home subscriber server, which is mainly responsible for service authorization and user authentication. Then what we have is service GPRS support node, SGSN. It is mainly used for controlling packet sessions and managing the mobility of the user equipment for GPRS network. So the next topic what we have is radio interface protocol. So as in other communication system which we studied, that the LTE radio interface mainly be designed based on layer protocol stack, which is divided into control plane and user plane protocol stacks. So which you can see in the figure there. So this is the LTE radio interface protocol stack. So packet flow in the user plane, which is also shown in the figure, next figure, that is the packet flow in the user plane. And this LTE radio interface protocol is composed of main layers called as radio resource control. So in the figure you can see their control plane, that is RRC, which is called as radio resource control. And one more is packet data convergence protocol, so that is PDCP. And next is radio link control, that is RLC. One more is MAC, that is medium access control. And last one is physical layer, that is PHY. Now in general, if we go into each of the layers, the first one what we have is radio resource control. So this performs the control plane functions, which includes mainly paging, maintenance and release of RRC connection and security, handling, mobility management and quality of service management. Packet data convergence protocol, the main function of this layer or PDCP sublayer, which include IP packet header compression and decompression based on the robust header compression, that is ROHC protocol, and ciphering of data and signaling mainly for security purpose, and integrity protection of signaling. So there is only one PDCP entity at the E node B and the user equipment per bearer. The third one what we have is radio link control, that is RLC. So the main function of this RLC sublayer are segmentation and concatenation of data units error correction through the automatic repeat request or ARQ protocol, and in sequence delivery of packets to higher layers. So it operates mainly in three modes. So first mode is called as transparent mode or TM mode, which is considered to be the simplest one, with RLC header addition, data segmentation and concatenation, and it is mainly used for special purpose such as random access. Second is unacknowledged mode, which is called as UM. So UM mode allows the detection of packet loss and also provides packet reordering and reassembly, but it does not require retransmission of the missing protocol data units, which is called as PDU. Third is acknowledged mode, it is AM mode. It is mainly the most complex one, and it is configured to request retransmission of the PDUs in addition to the features supported by the UM mode, that is acknowledged mode. So there is only one RLC entity at the E-node and again user equipment per bearer. The fourth one what we have is media access control. So there is only one, or the main function of this layer is include error correction through the hybrid ARQ mechanism and the mapping between logical channels and support channels or transport channels, multiplexing of demultiplexing of RLC PDUs on the transport blocks, priority handling between logical channels of one user equipment, mainly by means of dynamic scheduling, and the MAC sub layer is mainly responsible for transport format selection of scheduled user equipments, which mainly based on selection of modulation format, so which modulation to be used, code rate of that particular modulation format, MIMO rank and power level. The last layer what we have here is physical layer. So we know that the main function of this physical layer is actual transmission and reception of data in forms of transport blocks. So this physical layer is mainly responsible for various control mechanisms such as signaling of hybrid ARQ feedback, signaling of scheduling allocations and channel measurements. So this is the overall LTE radio interface protocol stack layers. So next class we will be dealing with the hierarchical channel structure of LTE. Thank you.